Hi there, welcome to my channel. I'm Christy. I am participating in the Three Rivers Challenge, Pantry Challenge. I am from Northern Alberta, Zone 2B, and I know that I have a lot of new followers and subscribers, so thank you for subscribing and following my journey here as I'm going through this Pantry Challenge in these extreme cold temperatures that we're experiencing up here in Northern Alberta. The difference between me and many other people who are participating in this pantry challenge is they are doing it as a goal. I am doing it as a necessity. As of right now, I am literally stranded at home by myself. No way to get into town. My truck is completely froze up. It won't start with a boost. It literally needs to have a heater put under it to thaw it out so we can get it started. I am not alone at night and stuff like that, but during the day I am here dealing with everything, all of our livestock, all of the house stuff, keeping everything from freezing up, keeping everything alive. That is my job here in these extreme cold temperatures. So how extreme is it? We had negative 51 below wind chills again last night. I did not get much sleep. I kind of wanted to pause a moment and I want to appreciate this challenge. I think that when Jessica at Three Rivers Homestead decided to start this challenge, she was really trying to challenge herself to use up what she had on hand, but I don't think she really understood that it really helped showcase people who do live in extreme conditions that don't have a choice. But this is their life. This is how they live their life. And I think it gives people like myself the opportunity to showcase that and kind of feel normal for a minute. You know, a lot of you that are following me and watching this video right now, you're watching it because you're either participating in it or you're wanting to learn how to participate in using what's in your pantry or cooking from scratch, those kind of things. And so I just wanted to pause for a moment and you know, thank her for seeing this need to fill this void in a lot of people's lives. So thank you. I appreciate this challenge and allowing me the opportunity to share what I know with the knowledge that I know with others, and to kind of give some insight into extreme emergencies of why this is important. I am in an extreme emergency. A lot of us up here in Alberta, this is normal life. Like, to me, this is just normal, but the reality of it is that if something happened where I was, you know, hurt or injured outside, it would be a very, very, very serious situation. Even if I just slipped and fell and broke a leg or something like that, it would be a lot. It would be a lot, because realistically, I can't even really carry a phone outside when I'm doing chores, when we have negative 51 wind chills, or when it's 45 below. The phone just, it dies. It's too cold unless I carry it against my body, which is usually what I do. But then I don't like to do that because of the condensation. So it's one of these things that I don't think about it. But it is an extreme. It is an extreme situation when you are living in a place where you do have weather conditions that can be extremely cold. Now, yesterday I talked about this a little bit, that this is not normal for Northern Alberta to have this long of a duration of cold temperatures. Last year, a coldest night, we had a negative 55 wind chill for one day. This year, we've had negative 55 to negative 59 wind chill several nights for weeks on end. And so this is not something that I've ever experienced in the whole 38 trips around the sun that I've made. This is not something that I've ever experienced before. And it's been cold like this since December. I remember on December 16th, because that's my birthday, and I was getting flowers, and some of them got a little bit damaged from being transferred from the truck to the house as birthday gifts to me. And so I remember it was really, really cold starting then, and it hasn't let up. So today we're into January now, and so we're several weeks into these extreme cold temperatures. Yesterday I talked about a chicken. I shared some insight about one of my laying hens that I had thought had I had lost her. And there was a, you know, the way she was laying, the way the other ones were scratching on her, I thought when I went back in there that she had for sure passed away. Miraculously, she's actually doing really, really well today. However, the extreme cold temperatures didn't let up at all last night. The wind picked up. I was up at 3 a.m. and I was up. I haven't really had much sleep. I've had like 20 minutes since 3 o'clock this morning. And I went to bed at, it was actually 1:30 or 2 o'clock in the morning because I was up with sick animals. And the sick animals, this is what's really frustrating. I couldn't get the feed that I normally do for the dogs and the cats. So I went to the grocery store the one day that I had a vehicle running that I could get into town. And the only thing open was the grocery store. So I grabbed some feed for the animals to get us by, and it's making everything sick. I had animals in the car garage. They have diarrhea everywhere. Sick, including our little house dog and the cat that's in the house, and it was disgusting. So I've been up dealing with that. I probably have to go check the garage again and see, make sure there's no more messes, because it's pretty gross. I've always fed our animals really good quality feed, so I've never had an experience like that where everything got sick from eating one type of feed, one brand of feed. So I don't know what's going on. I know I will not be buying feed that's on sale at the grocery store to get my animals by ever again. I'll cook them something before I will do that and put them through that ever again. So I'm really interested to know what's going on. I'm gonna actually see if there was a recall on that food or something, because something's not right. When you have livestock in northern Alberta climates, like where I'm at, or any animals, we are acclimated. I am acclimated to these conditions, and I know lots of people, they don't know how it's survivable. But you know, the temperatures, when they're really, really high temperatures, like hot temperatures, I have a really hard time with that. And my animals would have a really hard time with that because they're not acclimated to that. We thrive in cool conditions. My ideal temperature for working outside is negative 20 degrees. And the reason, degrees Celsius. And the reason for that is because when you live in a climate that's cold, it's the humidity that's dangerous. It's the moisture that is dangerous. Where we live, it's really, really dry, a dry climate. We don't, the air is dry. We don't have a very high humidity. And so one of the things, like it can be 30 below and it could feel warmer when you're working outside. It can feel warmer than it does when it is negative 10. There's a lot of humidity in the air. It will feel warmer to be working outside in 20 or 30 below in some cases because of the humidity. And that's how frostbite really affects people here and animals here in my climate, is the frostbite is affected by humidity. So one common practice is to make sure that there is a lot of ventilation in the coops for chickens or horses or cattle, like all livestock or people. It's the humidity. It's when you get the moisture on the skin, and then that moisture freezes, and it freezes the cell in the skin, and it freezes that tissue. But if you don't have the moisture freezing, your tissue stays warm. And so it's the humidity that is what creates such a big conflict when it comes to these cold conditions. My guinea fowl, I do not close up my coop. I keep a door open, like the little hatch open, for them to have really good ventilation, and the windows open. The reason I do this now, this is because I've had guineas for a few years. I took some advice from people who have raised birds in our climate, and I applied that knowledge and had a lot of success and with raising these birds and keeping them healthy. One of the things that a guinea fowl will do in this case here with mine, if I was to, or if the temperature in that coop was to warm up to minus 20 degrees Celsius, that guinea fowl, like the guinea fowl that were living in there, they would exit. They would try to leave the coop and they wouldn't stay in the coop. If it's negative 30 or negative 40, they are likely to stay inside as long as there's good ventilation. And the reason for that is because the temperature does increase when it's, of course, if it's minus 20, it is warmer than it is when it's minus 30. But the reason that they will escape or that they'll try to get out and not stay in the coop is because the humidity level, and that's when they begin to get cold. The temperature, the ambient temperature, and the decomposition of the deep litter and all those things contribute. There's moisture being generated. When the temperature rises, usually here in our climate, when it's warmer, it's more humid. When it's colder, it's drier, which could be different for a lot of other climates where many of you that are watching are from. So this is one of the things that I've learned, is that my guinea fowl, when I get that coop down to negative 20 or up to negative 20, they leave the coop and they try to roost in trees outside, which is not safe, because if a predator comes along and they decide to pluck out one of those guineas out of a tree, like an owl, I have a higher risk of losing more. Bringing the animals inside, unless it's an extreme emergency, when you have frostbite, if you warm up frostbite rapidly, it is really excruciatingly painful and it ruptures the cells and does more damage to your cells, the cells in the skin, than it would be to allow it to thaw naturally and allow that the body circulation to do its thing and heal itself. If I was to just blast hot air onto something that had frostbite, I would be putting that animal in excruciating pain and I would be causing more damage. And I know this because I've had extreme frostbite before where my skin has turned black or gray, and I've had blisters come because of the extreme cold. So I have experience because I live here. And so I just wanted to kind of help people understand, the climate is very different. The cold, living in extreme cold conditions is very different than in a lot of other places. Humidity, like many of you live in very humid climates, and you might get animals that have frostbite. They get really chilled, and you might lose a whole bunch if you have a day that it's like just below zero in your humid climates. Well, that's because of the humidity. It's because, one, they're not acclimated to those extreme shifts of temperature. Two, there is some conflicts with the humidity levels creating it harder. So one of the things that the humidity does affect is the lungs and stuff, and it becomes very hard to breathe. And then there's congestion and all the, you know, pneumonia can set in really easily when the humidity levels are too high when the temperatures plummet. So that's why I have that dish heater, because that dish heater tends to dry things. It dries out the surfaces of items. So it's actually eliminating how much I have, am creating for humidity in that coop. I need to cut more vents in that coop. That would prevent, like, this is controversial to so many, and I know many people won't be able to get this, but the reason my birds got frostbite last night or the night before was because I don't have enough ventilation in that coop. I need more holes in the walls of that coop, getting airflow so that the humidity is not going to sit on their skin and or sit on their, you know, exposed places like their feet or their combs or their wattles and create this kind of damage to them where they are getting some sort of a degree of a frostbite. So I hope that kind of helps someone in some way understand that this is, you know, this is why I can go out when it's minus 40 and I can cut firewood. I can cut fire because I'm acclimated to this climate. I can go aside and I could work out there for 5-6 hours, no problem. I'll come in, warm up my feet, do whatever, have a coffee, go back outside, as long as the humidity level is low. As soon as that humidity comes up and we get a pickup of a wind, there's no way, you know, because there's such a high risk of frostbite, there's such a high risk of hypothermia that it's unrealistic to be able to sustain those kind of temperatures for a longer duration of time. Right now, our humidity is high. We had a big snowstorm. Today we had, like, it was all foggy with ice fog in like around our home, around our properties. But I need to keep the moisture level down in the coops, both of them. Because clearly the moisture level is too high in these conditions. And with the way that our temperatures are changing, we're supposed to get to -6 in a few days. So our temperatures are gonna be really fluctuating. And I will guarantee you that when we hit that negative 20 degree or negative 10 degrees Celsius, those birds are gonna start getting cold. And they're gonna want to get outside, and the guineas are gonna try to roost in trees, and the chickens are gonna huddle up. They're not gonna eat, and they're just gonna sit there shivering. That's just how they are in this climate, because of that humidity is what causes a lot of conflicts in these birds. So I'm acclimated to the cold weather. My birds are, my livestock, all my animals are acclimated to the cold weather. I probably couldn't survive in Florida in the summer. I would be completely lost. If you put me outside and said, okay, go survive, there's no way. But you put me out here in the bush in the minus 40 and I'm fine. I can fend for myself. It's just what we're used to. And animals are just as adept, if they're more adept than human beings. They can survive better than we think without our interference trying to make them better. Just like horses and horse blankets. In our climate, putting a horse blanket on a horse in negative 40, it can really, really, really alter the way that they're able to regulate their body temperature, and it can actually be more harmful than good. So, which is, you know, something that I use natural remedy. I use their metabolism to keep them warm instead of putting something mechanical like a blanket that will mess up regulating their body temperature. A horse can't tell you, I'm too hot, take the blanket off. You know, like a person can kick the blankets off your feet. A horse can't say, I'm hot, I'm too hot, I'm getting too warm, I'm starting to sweat and the temperature's starting to drop. I have humidity on my skin. I'm getting a chill now. People think that the horse is shivering and they have a blanket on, so they need to keep the blanket on. Usually that's not the case. Usually the horse is freezing because the blanket is on them and they're not able to regulate their body temperature accordingly. So there's so many, there's so many views that I have very differently than other people because of my experience living here. Talking to veterinarians, talking to people who are homesteaders, who farm here, living here and knowing how to keep animals alive is very different in this climate than it is in other climates. And, you know, so not everything is always gonna be the same in every place you live or every channel or homesteaders operation. So just something to think about in the future. If something, you see something and you're like, yeah, well, it's, you know, this is way colder than what I'm used to, so that's not right. My climate is very, very different than other people's climates, and I do appreciate the care and concern that there are from people about the livestock and their well-being. But like I said, my animals, if you took a chicken from my house and you took it to someone's house in North Carolina, that animal would have a very hard time surviving with the change in, until they got acclimated to the temperature, they would be okay. But my animals here, they are bred for cold temperatures. They are hardy as can be. My guinea fowl, if they get outside when it's minus 20, I have a really hard time getting them in until it hits that 30 below. They will roost in trees until they realize that they're cold and they want to go inside. And it's just simply to do with the humidity levels. They know what's best for them. If they get cold, they'll go inside, right? And they don't need a mother hen like me saying, you go inside, you stay inside because you're going to be cold. They'll figure it out. I appreciate that there are people that do care about the well-being of animals. And I just hope that this is it's informative of what it is actually like to live in a cold climate. It's very, very different than a moderate climate. Extreme cold conditions are very different to have animals and for the safety of people and animals and things. You know, it's not the same. It's not the same as a moderate climate or a mild climate in any way. So, okay, I need to go do my pantry challenge. I don't know what I'm gonna make today. Any ideas? I gotta go scrounge. Maybe I'll have a nap and then I'll do the pantry challenge of some sort. That sounds like a really good idea, actually, after I'm done my coffee. I just brought her up here so she is closer to the heater. They want to like go party. They're happy, happy birds. Hey, ladies and gents. It's frozen. I gotta go get you a new one, girl. Gonna get you a new one. See, she already is looking back. She doesn't want to be over by the heat. She wants to be over there in her other spot where it's nicer. Okay, honey. Oh, you're gonna roost. That's a good spot. She's doing okay. She's trying to have a little nap. They're all kind of trying to sleep right now. I fed them earlier. It is much warmer in here. I'm a little concerned about how much humidity there actually is, but it's not so bad. They don't look like they have like ice crystals on them, on their faces or anything. It's actually not that cold. It's warmed up this afternoon by about 10 degrees. So for today's pantry challenge, I decided to make something that's very, very familiar to my family, and it is a dairy-free salted caramel dip. I use this as a dip for going hiking, when we go boating. I also use it as a treat. I sometimes will make the dip, and then I will blend it up with frozen bananas to make like a salted caramel nice cream. So it's really simple. You just take some cashews, some dates, some salt, and some vanilla, and you just blend it all up together. I highly, highly, highly recommend soaking the dates and soaking the cashews all together at least overnight, and then blending them up because otherwise they sometimes, if you're not using a really high powered blender, they definitely it doesn't make the nice smooth creamy consistency. And if you're doing it as an ice cream, you can always add a handful of chocolate chips or something, and if you're blending it up with frozen bananas later, and it has a nice smooth consistency if you soak it overnight. I was just doing apples. I wasn't really feeling very ambitious. It sounded like I was the only one gonna be home today. I did actually use some homemade vanilla extract in this recipe. I really enjoy this. It's a favorite go-to for my family. By the way, I will link in the description below a recipe similar to this one so that you can try it out for yourself. Thanks so much for watching. If you like this content, please like and subscribe.